Takže, čas se opět napojil, když to nám se udělal byla. Takže, dnešní den, nebo poslední přednáška je věnovaná velice zajímavé metodě, metodě bezkontaktního měření. Jsem rád, že zde můžu přivítat doktorku Ernu Kristerovu a pana Strahofera, který jsou ze společnosti Alicona Imaging, což je společnost, která se zabývá výrobou měřících systémů, kterých to vidíte následně, takže teda nás trochu nechám napnutý. A tady přednáška má podobně jako včerejší jednu návaznost, a to tu, že v podstatě nyní uslyšíte po teoretické stránce o těchto přístrojích, respektive o technologii, problematice toho měření, a potom v 16.15 opět můžete, pokud budete chtít, můžete navštívit společnost Hofmeister, kde v podstatě oni mají tento jeden přístroj k dispozici, používají ho, takže si potom můžeme si ho prohlédnout a případně se vlastně vyzkoušet nějaký to měření, který se tímto přístrojem dá realizovat. Jak to bude koncipováno? Pokud jim do přednášky počkáme do 4 hodin a ve 4 hodiny odsud, kdo bude mít zájem, odejdeme hromadně do té společnosti Hofmeister. Takže já už tímto končím své slovo před slovo a předávám slovo paní doktorce Kristýně.
However, I am Alina Kristýně. I come from Austria and I work for the company Alicona. And Alicona is an international leader in optical 3D measurements, and it is my pleasure today to make a presentation for you about graphless measurements. What is actually graphless? This is a central topic about which you heard a lot in the last days, and I would like just a small mention to make. It is so that we are living in a world which is going towards perfection. We like to have smaller cellular phones and better data processing and better medical implants, and all of them are reduced actually not only to the geometry but also to the surface finish. So if in Wikipedia it's described roughness the same as surface finish, I dare to say roughness can also be defined as quality. Because every business which is oriented only to the form is not anymore enough. So roughness is a key point towards quality. Before I tell you about... Is it going further? Into optical measurements. So, general terms, when we talk about optical measurements, it's not just roughness, but we also have a form of a certain tool, we have a certain orientation, so we speak about coordinate systems, we have a certain waviness, and obviously we have the roughness. The form, these are the basic geometric shapes like cylinders, cones, spheres, and so on. The roughness is a high frequency wavelength, while the waviness, I will also explain a little bit later, is a low frequency wavelength. And we also speak, when we have these terms and definitions, about filtering. This is a process of separating roughness and waviness. Here, a raw profile of a certain sample which can be divided into the primary profile and the form profile, and at its turn the primary profile can be again divided into the waveness, the low frequency or the high frequency, the roughness profile. I will also come back with more details later. there are many devices which were developed to measure form. We have coordinate measurement machines, which are using in a certain coordinate systems points, and then they are measuring distances between points, giving us that's the form. When we talk about roughness, there are the tactile instruments which are measuring roughnesses of the so-called kilometers. The infinite focus, to which I'm coming soon, is measuring both of them. Here are some examples of different surfaces where roughness is requested in the industry. When we need to measure roughness, we measure it optically. So everything what we can see with our eyes, also the infinite focus, the Alicona produced instrument can see it. So if it is glass or diamond, the light goes simply through and the surface cannot then be measured. So you have to have a sample which is not transparent. You have to have a locally roughness, a so-called nano-roughness. I'm coming again with the details on this. And I will have some typical materials, metal, synthetic, which can be measured. We have often to measure the appropriate flames with large scan range and large working distance, which is also necessary. The roughness profile looks roughly like this, as we see in this upper plot. And zooming in this roughness profile, we also have a certain nano-roughness, which superimposes the significant roughness. And this influences very much the measurability of optical measuring instruments. There are certain methods, which you probably know from your study, to evaluate if the roughness measurement is correct. This would be the measurement system analysis, the so-called MSA, with the six methods, the guide to the expression of uncertainty in measurement, and the gauge R&R studies, which are actually related to the measurement system analysis. All these methods are using calibrated comparison standards to demonstrate that the measurement device is able to measure a certain specimen. Now, so much about this introduction into optical metrology in terms and definitions. Now, let me explain you about focus variation. This is our main core technology at Alicona. Then to tell you why does this technology, this focus variation, work for roughness measurement, and why does our instrument, which you will see today in the afternoon, I suppose, at the Hofmeister company, patent. So we will see it today in the afternoon at Hofmeister. To answer the question, how do we know what we measure that this is the right thing? So how do we trace back these roughness measurements and how do we calibrate them? I show some practical results. Then a comparison between optical, what our instrument can measure, and the tactile, and show you a classification. Focus variation and infinite focus explained. This would be my first point actually for today. Imagine that you make a picture with your photo camera and you would like to see your friend and the background, which are the mountains or whatever. You cannot see both of them at the same time in focus. You see either your friend, which is in the picture, or the background, sorry. In order to see both of them, you need to move the focus. So you need to play with your camera, and this is exactly what is the code, what is this technique doing? It's moving the depth of the focus in order to capture the focus at every depth level in such a way that you get the, so to say, 3D model of what you would like to measure. And then we turn this picture down, and this is what our system is doing. This is, on the left side is our system, I think, here it is, where the Z scale is included here in the sensor. And this is moving up and down, where you have a joystick to control this movement, up and down. And by this movement of the focus, of the Z, we are also moving the focus. Here is a tool where you see certain points are in focus, and then again they are away. So this is a focus variation curve. For this measurement, 2 million such curves are being produced. So for every single point from this picture, 2 million points in this case, such a curve, I'm looking where is this point at its maximum focus. And we have such a curve at every single point. This has many advantages of looking at this maximum, because sometimes the sample is not so easily measurable, and therefore you would not have such a nice Gaussian-like curve, but you have it with many spikes, and you can make an interpolation and still extract the maximum where that point would be in focus. So this is how focus variation works, and this is how it is included into our Alicona infinite focus measurement system. As technical specifications, we have an optical 3D surface metrology based on a color focus sensor. So we are not just measuring the depth information, but also the real color, so the color. We have a vertical resolution of 10 nanometers, a lateral resolution larger than 400 nanometers, a scan height of 22 millimeters with a scan area with a laboratory system of 10 times 10 centimeters. The surface measurements, depending on how, what is the Z range which I would like to measure, are made in less than 16 seconds or more. We generate for every single measured frame 2 million points, and this means about 11.6 megabytes. It's not just one measurement that we can see through one objective, but we also can make image feeds. So we can measure much larger areas with the same resolution. Obviously, we are limited by the increasing data size afterwards. Which are the benefits of the focus variation? If you think about such a tool, which is a complicated geometry where also roughness might also be of interest. We can measure in one single measurement both form and roughness. There are many advantages. We can measure rough and smooth surfaces. We can get the color information, which is an important item whenever we measure corrosion, for instance. We measure stiff flanges up to 85 degrees inclination, diversity of materials, and also large measurement areas. So not only limited. This is the way it looks like. As I said, today at 4 o'clock, we will make a visit to the company Hofmeister, where you can see it live. And the infinite focus, which measures the form and extracting then this form and measuring also the roughness. Why does this technique work for roughness measurement now? So we measure a sample what is the performance? What we can measure is an RA. I think you are familiar already. You heard it in the last days about this RA parameter. We can measure it down to 50 nanometers, 0.05 microns, traceable and repeatable. I will come back to this topic of traceability and repeatability when I'm talking about the calibration tools. We have a measurement range beyond the typical piezo travel range, with a vertical resolution of 10 nanometers, lateral resolution of less than 1 micron. It is, as I said, able to measure steep slopes and handling of different materials through our own defined smart flash technology, so light settings. There are different light settings which we are using. When I say these are obviously sales arguments and specifications, but really technically, how do we achieve this? So we have a grain sensor basis, which is very stable. We have incorporated a 2 nanometer glass scale, which allows us this 10 nanometer vertical resolution. We have a stage, an XY stage, if we go back. This is the XY stage, which is moving back and forth, left and right. And here, except we have a square of 10 times 10 centimeters so that we see what we can measure. So this XY stages, also very accurate this movement. We have a specially designed optics, so we have a low noise, a high resolution, a high speed CCD sensor with a minimized temperature contribution, so it can be calibrated in different temperature conditions depending where your laboratory is. It has an optimized vibration isolation, so it is invisible, insensitive if you are walking nearby or a door is slapped, so this is not influenced.
I don't understand what that means, CCD sensor.
CCD, this stands for charge coupled device. I just wrote it here to me, that I get the definition exactly. The CCDs are sensors which are used in digital cameras and video cameras to record still and moving images. Mm-hmm. The CCD captures the light and converts it to the digital data so that it is recorded by the camera.
Yeah.
Okay, is this answering?
Okay.
And it is a high effort on system adjustment and the calibration using the PTB. This is a Physikalische Technische Bundesamt from Germany, and UKB, Deutsche Kalibrierung standards. So that means they are measuring this, they are giving to us, and we are re-measuring and getting the same values. So we can certify, yes, what we measure, it is exactly the real value. Mic and roughness, we measure with focus variation. So we have now, we exist since 2001. We have 11 years of effort with, now we have 20 people in the R&D team with competence in 5 PhDs, 18 masters and so on. The head of our R&D is an active member in the ISO committee where they are defining and working together for new standards and normatives. We have a strong cooperation with the National Physical Laboratory from England. And PTB, as I said, we have a competence in optics, metrology, mathematics, software development, and computer vision. We have here this roughness profile, which I showed you, I think, already, where, when zoomed in, there is a nano roughness. It is important to have a suitable vertical respectively lateral resolution when you measure roughness. So you cannot measure a roughness with a resolution if this is not smaller than the relevant lateral and vertical structures of the sample. So if this is a structure and I'm measuring with such a lateral resolution, I will just see it smooth. I can't see every signal detail. We have here a sample, this is a roughness standard, which has such a sinusoidal form. The principle of measuring is actually in the moving of the Z stage. So I'm a certain position above and I see the tops. So these are the tops of my sample. I see them sharp. Yeah? You see these black dots are sharp. While what is here down at the second position is unsharp. If you observe this, I hope the quality of the picture is okay. If I'm moving with a sensor down, I'm coming to the second position where I see everything what is down here, I see it sharp. While the first position where it's up here, I can't anymore see it sharp, so this would going to be unsharp. But with a certain vertical resolution here, I'm looking for every single point, which one is in focus, in such a way that at the end I'm getting a very nice picture of the whole sinusoidal surface. This is, as for your information, since the human eye can distinguish the sharp and unsharp areas, the system, which is an optical system, can as well distinguish this. Now, what is about our instrument? Which are the advantages of the infinite focus for roughness measurements? I will give you an example of measurement of small structures. This is the roughness tool, which we call it IF Roughness Tool 100, meaning an RA measured by PTV of 100 nanometers. I will show you some measurement of samples with small random structures, like this random roughness standard. We can measure large scan height, larger than 400 microns possible, and we also video some examples on this, and show you how large working distances are possible, like an injection nozzle or a PET flow. Let's take this roughness to 100. So I have to do something. But it's a problem. Often small roughness, like for instance this tool of 100 nanometers on small samples with very small lateral structures, smaller than 10 microns, have to be measured. This is not just about this tool, but this is about a two-thin plug, for instance, which has to have a certain nano roughness, because if it does not fulfill these conditions of the roughness, it would hurt when it's implanted in your body. So these are some practical examples as well. So how do we measure this? What is the condition? The condition is that the measurement device must possess a small lateral and vertical resolution. Don't forget we have the 10 nanometers vertical resolution with our infinite focus and less than, down to 400 nanometers lateral resolution. This is the way it looks like when measured with our system in pseudo color. So the real color we saw, we can measure it. Here we have the color scale with a 0, minus 400, plus 600 something. So this is the way it looks like, a sinusoidal tool. After having measured it, we draw a profile along it with a certain width. And this is the generated profile. One still can recognize there is a certain wavelength, but this doesn't matter. So we measure here an RA of 100.27 nanometers. It is necessary to be able to measure small lateral structures, like, for instance, a distance from peak to peak between the structures, which can be also 10 microns, or a distance here inside, to still be able to solve this region of 5 microns. And this should not be a problem for the optical instrument. Again, another problem is that nearly all the real samples have small or random structures. Not all of them have this nice sinusoidal structure, but some of them are just random. Like example, precision components, mild parts, roughness standard with random structure, which I'm going to show you. The solution is the infinite focus, as I said, which has a small lateral resolution, and the evidence is a comparison of a focus variation measurement with a tactile measurement device on a random DKD calibrated roughness standard. We still have an oriented structure, which is directed in a certain direction, but the heights are not so sinusoidal. They have different lateral structures and maybe different, different heights. So this is a used roughness standard manufacturer from Lübeck, from the United Kingdom, which has a random structure and which has a length of 4 millimeter times 1.25. You see on the upper side the true color picture with a profile path, and this is a generated profile as it was measured. The tactile measurement device, we have to say it was not measured at the same position as above, so it cannot certify that exactly at this micron they also measured it tactile. Maybe they were measuring a little bit higher or lower, or maybe not so straight, maybe a little bit. The question is obviously how good is the correlation between these two profiles? Are they the same or not? how do we solve this? So first of all, we take two tactile measurements of different positions. Think about how this is looking like. Yeah, this is the sounder. And we measure it twice tactile, once here and once higher. And we superimpose these two tactile measurements to allow the estimation of the homogeneity of the tools. Because the tools might not also be homogeneous with exactly the same structure. Then afterwards we superimpose the tactile and the infinite focus measurement. This allows the estimation of the correlation, what we were asking before, between the optical and the tactile measurement. And then calculate the correlation coefficient for quantification. In the upper picture we have the comparison of the two tactile measurements, which gives a correlation of 0.68. So not really relevant, so to say, you know, correlation between 0 and 1. If you make a comparison of the tactile in this here, red, and the infinite focus measurement with green, we see also not the best correlation, but at least it is higher than this. So we have here, we look at what is the valley to peak structure, and then in order to know previously how well we need to measure this, with which vertical respectively lateral resolution. We can say that both tactile profiles show some deviations. The tool is not completely homogeneous. This is a basis for us to know, can we compare optical and tactile, and which are the results that we can expect. The reason might be that there are some artifacts, they might be also dust during the measurement, which is also visible on the tool. The graphs, tactile versus optical, do coincide better than the tactile. Hence, there is a very good correlation between the optical and tactile measurement. The influence of the sample is much more evident than the influence of the measurement device. So, you saw it also in numbers. If it's not one, the correlation coefficient to say yes, it is exactly the same, but is in any case better than when we compare two tactile measurements. Here we have also on a measured length of 1.25 millimeter using a cutoff wavelength. Maybe I'm going too much in detail because I didn't speak about this. Of 0.25 millimeter, the tactile stylus radius is 2 microns, because you have also to think, I'm going to show you something. If you're measuring, such a thing, and that the tip of the tactile measurement is so large, yeah, which has a radius of, I don't know, in this case, let's say 2 microns radius, it will not solve here. This tip is not going never to reach here to see exactly this profile, while an optical device obviously would be able. But I'm coming to this later because I also these two microns. So the lateral resolution of the infinite focus is 0.9 microns, which was used, and the objective the 100 times. The infinite focus has 6 objectives because I'm still at this topic, 2.5, 5 times, 10 times 20, 50, and 100. So, and these are the values. An average RA, minimum, maximum, and the same repeatability of 3 nanometers. We can measure more than 400 microns range, and this comes very often in the practice. Whenever a tool producer says, I'd like to measure the roughness, maybe this is important also for Ivana, roughness on the flag. So, if I'm measuring from the top here, and I have here is interesting for me the roughness, or here in the flute, yeah, then I need some working distance or some Z range to solve more than only 10 microns, for instance. So I need to see more with this. We have here measured this roughness on the flange. we get an RA 766 nanometers, and also in the fluid after removing the form of 449 nanometers. The problem is the measurement of roughness over large vertical scan ranges. Like an example, we have measurement of roughness on tilted surfaces, or measurement, as I showed you, on the thread or in the flute, the measurement of roughness on precision components with tilted surfaces. The infinite focus enables measurement up to approximately 85 degrees. So if you're measuring from above, where the light is coming, you put your sample flat, simply on the stage, but you need to measure roughness here. The problem is that it is still the best is when you measure the roughness on something which is flat. I'm just measuring, I see exactly what I need to see, but in this case I need to roughness exactly here, and I cannot always tilt the sample so that I'm measuring from this side. So the sample has to be measured to measure roughness at a certain tilted angles. And we also have the advantage of scan ranges up to 22 millimeters. I give you an example of measurement of a roughness tool 500, an RA of 500 at different inclinations. Here another example where the roughness here on the flute is important to be measured, but you have no access unless you have a large working distance. This is a roughness tool, which normally looks like this, this nice sinusoidal shape, which we, for testing purposes, we have tilted this up to 45 degrees and measuring from above. And these are the results, what we get here. So here is the sample inclination in angles, and we see here which are the obtained values. I'd like to show you again a picture. When you have such a roughness when still, we are measuring from up, and we have such a sample which is taken. The customer would like to know what is the roughness here, but he would like to know it when I'm measuring this way. If this roughness is happening on a not easily achievable sample, then I have to measure it while tilted at a certain angle. Yeah? This alpha. What happens, however, if I'm measuring from above, I will not see certain areas. So these are the so-called undercutted areas. So I'm not going to see this because while I'm looking from above, I cannot see it on the corner. And I'm not going to see this, and also this. So what I'm measuring at the end is actually such a roughness, which is not relevant. Might have differences up to 100 degrees sometimes. Yeah? So we are estimating also an accuracy, or we are calculating how much is allowed to tilt the sample in order to still get reliable results. Here we have the same measurement an SA. This is the almost the same parameter as RA, but is in terms of surface. So RA is only a longer profile, and SA is the same parameter, the same calculation on the whole surface. And at different tilts, we have SA, or the quadratic mean S2 of these values. We see how they are varying depending at different tilted areas. So we can state we get consistent results. Here another example where large working distances are requested, like for injection nozzles, a flute of a tub, or a root of threads from implants, or diversion precision components. Here you see the nose of the infinite focus with the mounted six objectives, and here you see the working distance. It is important that it is not so close because it might cause a collision between the sample and the objective itself. And you see also here the values for all six objectives, with the largest value for the five times objective, 23.5 millimeters. The customers are asking, how do I know that this is exactly the roughness which it is on my sample? How do you prove this? So we measure it. We get the profile standard, which is conform, built in the software according to the ISO 42877. And this measurement, this roughness tool, was previously measured by the old Deutsche Kalibrierdienst lab, which is also traced back to the PPD 5.1. So whenever we deliver a certificate for a roughness tool, we have the complete traceability is given within this certificate. When we come to surface texture measurement, just shortly tell you about surface texture. So imagine the map of Czechian, of Czech Republic. I'm sorry about my geography because I don't know exactly how Czech is looking like. But imagine it described the relief of Czechian with only one line from west to east. And you get maybe some mountains or some valleys, or yeah, you get just a line. And then you can say, based on this line, this is the way my country is looking like. But this is not the truth. You would need to know if you have mountains or valleys or, see, I think it's not. Yeah. So you need to know the whole area. And this is what exactly the SA parameter is doing. It describes the whole area in terms also of volume parameters. It shows us where we have cavities or where we have mountains. So this is the main difference between RA and SA. There is intensive work which is at the moment done because most of the producers of high precise tools recognize that the RA parameters are not anymore relevant for them, so they would like to know, is my sample has a lot of spikes or is just along this profile where maybe I'm missing a corrosion depth. So these are the S parameters, and there is a surface standard which is in work, where PTB and Japanese authorities are involved. There is an ISO committee 25178, which is not yet finished, but where Alipurna is strongly involved within this work. The DKKS labs, which are not yet available, and the PTB 4.5.1, also all the open geometric product specifications, which are not yet defined. This is not a complete chain, of course, but this does not mean that the area-based roughness measurements may not be used. We are measuring them, and we are giving roughness parameters in terms of the whole surface and not only the R parameters. We are measuring actually both of them. There are on the market available roughness standards. The problem is that they have such a sinusoidal-like structure, and they are too smooth and too specular. So the light is simply coming and immediately reflected. You have no such a nano roughness where you can really see. If they are too shiny, they are very difficult to be measured. Not even think about to get calibrated values here. So this is actually the roughness with an R max, and we can consider this actually as a form, yeah, a super smooth surface. Has no local nano roughness, shiny surface, hard to measure for optical instruments, not only Alipurna, but other optical instruments as well. And the roughness of the standard is considered this standard form. Using a special technology, which is like sand blasting, these very shiny standards already existing, a certain nano roughness is generated so that the light can be reflected back to the objective and gathered within the objective. So now we have in this profile, we have the form, the same form which remains, and the local nanoroughness. The significant local nanoroughness makes possible to be well measurable by optical and by tactile instruments. As it was before, also with this nanoroughness, the roughness of the standard remains still reduced by the sine waveform. So the Alicona roughness standard, which we are measuring, looks actually like this red shape. We can separate this actually. When we consider the black line as a form or as a waveness, using a small cutoff wavelength, maybe I should go into the detail, but I think it's and get this nano roughness, which is not, it's like a form, the error of the standard. Yeah, it's not anymore so smooth. It's a kind of error, but exactly this error, this nano roughness, helps us to really measure it. In order to measure it, the local roughness should be more than 10 to 15 nanometers. Otherwise, it's too smooth for the optical system and it cannot measure it. This is the way it looks like. So, in the past, there were not such a standards available. There were only this specular nice sinusoid form, which is very, they are very good for the tactile, yes indeed, but not for the optical. And this is now what Alicona has produced, and these are certified values of 100 nanometers, 500, 1500, and 3000 nanometers. Every such a tool, roughness tool, comes also with a certificate, so they are also given to PTB or to DKB to be measured, and afterwards we perform the same measurement. So we show that our roughness measurements are traceable, are exactly the absolute value which the customer sees in this certificate. We use for the measurement of this tool, it's not clearly seen, I don't know, Pavel, do you have such a roughness tool at Hofmeister? Maybe then we can show it, because in the picture here you see it's not clearly seen, this nice structure. We measure this with a 50 times objective with a vertical resolution of 50 nanometers, and we make an image field. So what we see through the 50 times objective is a very small, it's just 700 microns, not even one square millimeter you see through the 50 times objective. So you make an image field where you put one near the others and then they are aligned in the same coordinate system, also looking at the color information, and then we get such a long and perfect measurement of 10 times one, so 10 such pictures are aligned. You remember already the profile roughness measurements, which are giving us the RA values. So we have a profile part here. Here we see how the profile is looking like, this extracted profile. We use as isoform form a lambda C of 250 microns, and then the RA value is obtained. Here we have an average area of uncertainty and a certain repeatability, both for the tactile systems and for the glucose. We can state therefore that the infinite focus is comparable with tactile measurements, that the infinite focus has a better repeatability, and we can also, we have to say that the infinite focus has a worse uncertainty. The uncertainty of a measurement is including also the uncertainty with which it is given to us. So the tactile instrument says we are measuring an RA of 97 microns with an uncertainty of 5 nanometers. That means when we are taking this and calculating our own uncertainty, we have to take into account with which uncertainty, what was the nominal value given by the tactile instrument. and the nominal value is given nominal value plus this uncertainty. Therefore, in our optical uncertainty calculation, the tactile is included. Yeah? And therefore, it is worse. Actually, we have a better repeatability. We can measure it better, but we have to refer to the tactile system. So it includes its uncertainty. Here are the data for the roughness to 300, so 3 micron RA. And here an overview of the roughness measurements with standards. Once more, the uncertainty of the optical will be always worse because it has to include the tactile uncertainty as well. The roughness standards are calibrated roughness standards where the structure is measured with a reference measurement device, so we get a reference value for roughness values for the certificates. It assures the reference to the national standards, and it assures the reproducibility with other measurement devices. The institutions which are allowed to make such calibrations are national institutions, DKD, BDB, and NIST, for instance. Here is the Japanese one. There are two types of standards, periodical roughness standards and random roughness standards. The roughness standards have to be practice oriented, so you will not measure, you do not have to measure very shiny, extremely shiny, because in the practice, you do not only have shiny samples. It has to have a locally roughness or a certain nano roughness in order to be able to be measured with an optical device. And if you want to compare it, it should have an RA value as a workpiece to be measured. So I'm not going to prove that the roughness of 500 microns and then prove it with a certificate of 100 nanometers. So it should have a similar R value and the similar optical characteristics as the workpiece to be. There are some problems when measuring the roughness standard. So the roughness standard is not applicable for every measurement technology. That means that the measurement is not ideal and the roughness measurement is far away from the calibrated value. Like an example, when you use very smooth roughness standards for optical roughness measurements, a problem which we have already solved. A problem can also be that we are not measuring at exactly the same position. This is very important whenever we compare tactile and optical measurement. I will also show you the problems of the tactile instruments as they are generating scratches in this standard. And also a problem might be that not the same measurement settings are being used, like filter settings or the duration of the measurement. Here are some examples. Here is an injection nozzle, which are used in the automotive industry. We have a high resolution 3D measurement of the entire ceiling, which you see here. Then we need to remove the bevel form and to calculate the flatness parameters, FATT, according to this ISO standard. The fuel supply is closed with this tool. So here are the contact points. The question from the customer comes, is the fuel supply with closed valve interrupted, so that means it is sealed or not, or it's open and everything is flowing. So these are the boundary conditions with multiple injections of lowest qualities, pressures up to 2000 bar and so on. How do we solve this question in terms of roughness? We need to see how flat it is there. Yeah? So if I want to see how flat it is, I need to remove first the form. Before I go here, I would like to show you a small sketch. sketch about four movement. If you have such a sample, which has a surface like this, yeah, the customer is asking, what is the roughness of this sample? If I do nothing, I just measure it from above, and then I see what is the roughness, then I have here Z information, and here the length, let's say we speak in 2D, the length of the profile. Then I put all these heights here, yeah, and I get a certain RA. Then I say the sample is very rough, but actually this sample has a shape, and this shape has to be removed first. The shape is this one. If I'm removing the shape, I'm left with such a thing, which is flat. And now I can tell to the customer, this sample has a certain roughness. That length, yeah, which is much smaller than this actually. So the customer has a more real value for his roughness. But he says, actually I'm interested if the fluid is still flowing, and the fluid is flowing here exactly, so I need to remove this waviness, because a certain waviness is still present. And then I'm looking in Z to this roughness. And then I can tell him, is the fluid flowing on me or not? Because when the ball is closing, which is closing here, I want to see if this is sealed. And in these terms, I can answer to his question. So it's not just how rough is my sample, just measuring. You have to remove the form, eventually remove the waviness with this cutoff wavelength, and then you look at this roughness. And here, this is what the software is doing in its utilities. It has the possibility, you see here, the pseudo color. And this is magenta, here violet. Here is low, so this is a conical surface, which was measured from above. That is like a disc, and it's oriented down. And now I'm removing this conical surface. Now I have here the possibility to say a cone, or I'm using a second order polynomial, which is the same. And then I get a flat sample, yeah, which has the same color everywhere. I already see some problems here on this injection nozzle. Here is might be something which is still remaining after removing this ideal form, and therefore this injection nozzle might not anymore be so good. What I can also do is to look at the roundness. I'm looking on this sample. I'm just cutting it with a plane, I make a cross section, and then I see how round it is. Is it perfectly round, or which are the deviations in terms of roughness parameters from the ideal form? This is what this plot is showing us. These are the polar coordinates. This would be the ideal form. The ideal form, and here are the deviations from the ideal form. And then we can identify and say, here might be some leakage. Here is a table with some static which was based on 20 measurements. This Rhone, A, Hu, TP, and V are roughness parameters in terms of roughness. So the deviations of the shape from the ideal form. And you also have the repeatability, or the so-called standard deviation for these measurements. And this is how we provide the customer with more information. Last but not least, we have the pseudo color, so the optical measurement itself, and the real color, where we might identify also in real color some problems on this sample. Here is, if I'm looking in the surface texture, so not just making a profile and getting the roughness, but considering the whole area of this sample after removing the form and getting it flat, and then I'm looking at the roughness parameters, filtering out the eventual waviness which might still be present. You see here, this is going down, up, down, up. This is the pseudo color, which is shown here, but it's higher than this dark blue here. That means we have a certain wavelength, which is still present. And I'm removing this with this cutoff wavelength, a parameter which is lambda c, which is well known in the roughness topic. And this is what we get after filtering out the wavelengths, you remember here? So I had this, okay, not so many, I had only two, and I'm removing this wavelength, and I'm now getting only this roughness. And here I get the values, SA, average height of the selected area, with a height histogram, which shows me the sample is, this is also a matter of interpretation, how we interpret this histogram. And we see here, for instance, valleys or peaks, maximum peak height of the selected area, maximum valley depth. I'm going to see if my sample is perfectly smooth, or how do I have here more valleys or more peaks. Actually, I have more peaks because SP is larger than SV. Yeah? If a certain skewness, and if the sample is oriented like under the zero level, so we can interpret it with different parameters. I will come back to this SDR parameters. Don't forget about this. This is a very important parameter when we talk about roughness. When doing several measurements, we also get the standard deviation. So another example here, you see the standard deviation for this S parameters, which can be done. A second example, let's take paper. In the paper industry, it is a topic if the paper is good, well printable, or not well printable. So how do we solve this? We come again to the topic roughness. The producer would like to know which kind of paper should he take, or how maybe the fabric should produce. This is the workflow for the roughness measurements. And first of all, form removal, I have to decide if I'm measuring with a profile roughness, with the RA, if they are relevant enough for me, or if I'm going to the area measurement and choosing which lambda C if I have a certain wavelength. And then I get the parameters. But now I have many parameters. Which ones are relevant, actually? This is how a paper is looking like, in real color and pseudo color, where one can already recognize the fibers of the wood. We have here the original measurement, where we have some areas, like some hills, which are coming higher from the sample. Yeah? And these are generating a certain waviness in my sample. And after I'm filtering this out with a certain value of the lambda c, I'm getting this block here. We can make a profile roughness, like such a zigzag profile, or to make an area roughness where everything is taken into account. If you are looking at the RA comparison with SA, this is how we get this, along this profile, or the height histogram, I see here I have a higher value. This is always going to happen like this, because with this profile, maybe I'm meeting, or maybe not, the deepest points, which are with violet. But here, I'm taking everything, so I will always have here more relevant values. And the S parameters are always larger than the R parameters. So, a good printability looks this way, very compact, and a poor printability looks this way. It's a lot of holes or hills, or it's very irregular. So only optically can one can already see, okay, this is better printable, this is worse printable. But we are going also to the parameters, and we see here this the good printability. This is very smooth, very compact. We have almost 700 nanometers, while we here have already microns, 4.3 almost microns. Also, the bearing area curve, I will explain also a few things about this, is showing us a good printability versus a poor printability. This is the SK value, you see a difference, yeah, 6 times larger for the poor printability. A third example, you might ask, what has the surgeries of a broken bone have to do with the roughness? But this has to do because in a broken bone, there has to be a surgery where an implant is fitted on the bone, and afterwards, 8 weeks normally, or sometimes more, it might be left inside, which might cause some problems, or you have to make a second surgery to take it out. And this is very often for the children, you know, second surgery, because their bones are growing and the implants have to be taken out. We have a cooperation project which is still running. This is Dr. Annelie Weinberg from Laura Bessie Zentrum, PIC, which is working also at the hospital in Graz. And the project was called Bioresorbable Implants for Children. These are some studies of implants which are made of material which are dissolving in the body. So these not anymore metallic implants, which have to be implanted and you have to see if the roughness is okay for this roughness, but implants which simply dissolve. And that means that the second surgery would not anymore be necessary, which I believe all the parents agree with that. So what it was done, she gave us implants, which we measured before being implanted in bodies. We had rats. So she had, and after 8 weeks they were taken out and measured again, and depending on the roughness parameters we could see are they dissolving faster or too slowly, and the ones which are dissolving faster they have to be taken because these are the ones which are then absorbed by the body. So, and these have to be measured with the roughness parameters, of course. Our task was to find a correlation between the surface and the biological behavior of these implants. So we had rough surface, we have different materials, so 3 types of materials. She needed to have a non-destructive measurement, so tactile was not a question for these applications because the stylus generates some scratches and the implants are very sensitive. And repeatable and traceable measurements were required. They are planning for the future. If this is a bone, there is better missing. And inside here, the implant is. How do you measure the roughness? Don't forget, we have exactly this situation. The form has to be removed afterwards. Eventually, the roughness, the waviness. And then the roughness is of interest for her and for us as well. We had 3 different materials which were measured, and the difference was just the percentage, sometimes more of one mineral or less was used. And this is the material comparison. After the 8 weeks, and one sees that the third material, the same analysis was necessary to be used. So for the third material, we see still the processing, the waviness and the roughness, which is still on the implant. So for the 8 weeks, no absorption has been happened. For the second material, we see it better, and for the third material, with the highest roughness, that was decided, okay, this is the one which has to be used. A few things about tactile and optical. There are many companies which are still measuring tactile, yeah? And we are providing optical measurements, and we always say they are better. And I would like to show you how we compare these, which are the advantages and disadvantages. So a tactile instrument measures the contact between the tactile tip here and the specimen surface. This is moving, simply this capillary is moving, and this is thus generating a profile. The problem is that this stylus tip is not sharp, but it's round actually. And that means that the tip is not measuring exactly the surface, but only the contact points of the tip and the surface. So this is first one disadvantage. Then you might see here some machining traces from the sample itself. Here you might see the measuring traces, so some scratches which were caused by this needle. You see here some deposits on the sample. This is silicium crystal, which are hard. And you also see here some L matrix, which is soft. Now here you see at 5, the stylus is coming, and here it meets this hard material, and it is deviated, so it's not anymore measuring as it should measure. Not even to mention that it is not measuring perpendicular to these situations. So in an optical device you do not have this problem. You can put your profile wherever you like. So to improve, and the tip is deflected. So we already recognize some problems of the tactile instruments. There is a slipping effect, a bouncing effect, some material deformation which might be caused by the tip. It is less informative. It's a single profile. Don't forget about the geography of our country. The tip wear has also to be taken into account, because the needle is not for years to be used, but it's maybe several times. This is also going to be worn. The user does not know afterwards maybe where the profile was measured, because with an empty eye you might not see this. You have a limited vertical scan range. You cannot measure very much. You often only roughness can be measured, only without form, and no stiff flanks are possible to measure. Of course, the optical instruments have also their own problem, because as we are seeing about the roughness standards, they are too smooth and specular for optical systems. Some optical devices, for instance, the white light interferometers, are not optimal for certain roughness measurements. At different scales, when we compare these, so when we compare tactile with optical, in case of big measurement values, so like millimeters range, we have very small differences. It depends on the applications always. So if with a tactile instrument you have to measure 1 millimeter roughness, you also get the same with an optical device. It depends on the applications. This is a very important point, because if you're measuring on a tilted flank, then we might get different values. In case of medium measurement values in the micron range, it depends on the surface roughness, and material differences can occur. But at small measurement values, at the nanometer range, so 100 nanometer RA, the large differences can be expected between optical and tactile measurements. When comparing the size, as I said, the tactile instrument, the size and the form of the stylus tip influences the measurement results, and the interaction of the stylus tip is complex to understand. You don't know exactly what is happening on the sample, if the stylus meets a hard particle or a soft particle. In case of optical instruments, the tactile roughness standards are often too smooth. Some optical systems, and the problems of the comparison procedure is that it is difficult to find the same measurement position, and even if you find it, maybe it was scratched by the tactile and then you still cannot pay the same values. Because the customer says, I measured this, and this has an RA of 300. How do you come with your optical device if you say this is 500? Yeah, but then I have always the explanation. Do we know it's in the same place? Do we have the same number C? Do we have the same tilting? So you have to have the correct measurement position, the structure of the roughness standard and part should be nearly equal, tactile or optical, which is more accurate. It's especially on random roughness specimens, and the international standards are not completely unambiguous. It might be also that different software gives slightly different results on the roughness values. The advantages of the optical instruments are the following. Typically, the complete area is measured. You have the measurement as measuring for the first time. It's always new, no scratch, no wear. You have more data points, which are measured in less time, so it's more efficient. You have more data points, which allow filtering surface and the surface parameters. So with one set of data, I can measure RA and SA values. You have no contact with the samples, no wear on the surface, and you also have the true color information. When compared to the tactile measurements you see here, which are the advantages of the infinite focus over a profilometer, we can measure areas instead of only profiles. We can measure form and roughness at once. With one measurement, we have a high vertical scan range with our different objectives. We use real color information to know where we are measuring. We can measure elastic materials, which is not the case for the tactile, for the elastic materials. High lateral resolution and sampling. We have less maintenance. There is no stylus stick, which needs a replacement. It's not only for flat samples and very flexible measurement options. We have both of them, profile and area measurement, in our software. The profile measurement fits very well when you have to compare it with tactile measurements or with surfaces which are oriented all in the same direction, for example, the turned surfaces. The area measurement is interesting when measuring the flatness of a surface. You like to see how flat it is, so you need the surface. When measuring the roughness of structured surfaces with complex forms, remember about the paper surface, or surfaces with random surface texture and complex parameters. There are many parameters which are describing this roughness, not only R and SR. We have here two different samples, but the same profile. So if you make a profile from left to right, we get exactly the same, but completely different surface structure. So you can imagine in the surface texture analysis that we would get absolutely completely S parameters. The advantages of the area measurements are that you get more repeatable results, more complex parameters are possible, you can have volume parameters, you have less user influence because it's not just the student or the operator who designs, who makes a profile and he does it for exactly where his colleague last day was measuring the profile. So the user influence is less minimized with this. And much more parameters. For your information, because I was talking so much about this RA, this is a definition which I found in the book. The average roughness RA, this is an integral of the absolute value of the roughness profile, which you see here. It is a shaded area divided by the evaluation length, and this is the most commonly still used roughness parameter. If you think about SA, then it's a double integral, means dx dy. In terms of roughness, it's not just RA, but also this profile, black line, is divided into five sections, and for each of these sections we are looking at the maximum, right? And then we are actually calculating an average peak to very high of the roughness profile. This is an RZ. This is also very often given because the customer would like to know in average what is the distance between the highest point and the deepest point. But this is RZ is just an average. There are also the RT, which is the maximum along the whole profile between the maximum point, which is happening here, and the lowest point, which is happening here. Or the R max, which is in one of these sections, which is the highest Z. So there is also another method, which is not implemented into the Alicona software. This is a VDI roughness method, which is, this is a very old method, this Verein für Deutsche Ingenieure, and this is the formula, so if you need somewhere this FDI, just you can transform it into RA or the other way around. The SDR I showed you in the surface texture, this is a very interesting parameter, because here is your surface, but if you it's like you have a paper, which is, it's like a surface which is like this, yeah? And what is this, the area of this? If you are measuring from here to here, so but you can flatten it, then I get a stretch profile, yeah, which is much longer, and I can express this in terms of percentage. So here I have a small SDR, that means my surface is something like this. So I can okay, it's not maybe so rough based on this SDR parameter. Or I have a surface which is really like this, which I have this case. So this is one example in only one parameter, how can I describe the roughness, depending on the customer's definition. I'm approaching almost okay, not too many. But I think this is important because this is very used in the roughness topic. So there is a so-called bearing area curve. If we come back to this paper, the bearing area, bearing is mean, it means like carrying something, yeah? If I put on this, on such a surface, an object, which are the contact points which will carry the load, yeah? So I can describe this. It's very little, it's only here and here. A lot is what is inside. And this is the principle of this bearing area curve. We would have a small bearing, then we have a lot of peaks, and the heavy thing is carried only on the peaks, and it's a small bearing area curve. This is the Firestone-Abbott curve. Maybe you learn, or you will learn about this. And I have a good, a very large bearing area when my surface is flat. And I'm sure you know this is how it looks like, and this is how it is for rough surfaces. This is how it's looking like. So if I put an object here, it will only lay on these peaks. And then when I'm expressing these peaks in terms of height, yeah, at zero, of course, I have the most of them. And then this is interpolation of this, and I have such a bearing area curve where, for instance, here only at least 4%, this is a SMR, one parameter, something is carried here. So a very low bearing area, and this is indicated by a steep slope. And now I show you how to calculate this. So this is how we got to the bearing area, so this is how we get it here. And now the calculation of the parameters. Based on that curve, we fit at 40% of this minimum slope a line. Yeah? Here we have percent and here we have height information. We fit a line, and at this intersection with the height, then these parameters, RPK, this is the core reduced peak height. So how much peaks do we have in average on our surface? And here we have how much varies. This is the RVK, this is our core roughness. If we have here a lot of tilting, that means a low bearing area. And if this is very flat, then I can say, oh, my surface is very flat, so it has a good bearing area curve. This is, for instance, for honed surfaces. In the process of honing, all the peaks are just reduced, and it looks something like this. So if I put something, you just have it. It's a very good bearing area. And this is how the bearing area curve is looking, like here. Yeah? And so a large bearing area is indicated by a small slope at the beginning of the area curve. Also, based on this bearing area curve, the volume parameters are calculated. We have between, in the core roughness, we have material, or we have voids. We have empty, like a porosity. So we can describe in terms of volume, void, core. In the core, if we have some voids, or volume, voids, valley, this VVV. How much do we have from our material, from our roughness? Do we have more material here or more empty spaces? We have a lot of peak volumes or more valley volumes. Is the oil going to flow through or is it going to be sealed? Just to come back to the previous example. Yeah, here is another explanation based on the bearing area curve, how these volumes are calculated. The question is when to use these volume parameters. When you have the software, when you learn roughness about the roughness parameters, you recognize your own application and then you decide yourself, you can decide by yourself which parameters you are going to use. If not, Alipona can help you with this. So you have here two kinds of surfaces, yeah, which give us the same RA values, because in profile, I have the same height from here, distance, I get very similar RA, R2, RZ, to get what it was, and also the same from the S parameters, but if I'm looking then farther to the bearing area curve, I will get complete different parameters. So because here I see more voids, yeah, or here I see more volumes, and here I see more voids. Last but not least, the classification. This is my last point. How can surface parameters be quantified by measurement parameters? We say always it's depending on the application, what you would like to see. We have to understand, is this a medical implant? Is this has to do with corrosion? Or is this a tool where also the geometry has to be okay? We have to decide and to make a classification. The classification or the selection is a step of determining the relevant parameters to distinguish good from bad parts. Yeah? The customer comes to us with two injection nodules, two valves, and says, one is good, one is not good, but I have the same RA parameters. Okay, then I have to look which are the volumes parameters, which is a fractal dimension, or maybe there is a gradient distribution for these two samples. So, why is this important? It helps the user to identify the relevant parameters, and it helps in classifying the unknown parts. It might have the same RA, but it will have different volumes parameters. So, if we look at the volumes and say, these are the parameters how you will distinguish in the future from your samples. There are different parameters to characterize the surface in terms of roughness. These are just some of them. The question is which parameters should be used for which applications. We have here again a practical example where the same SA, very similar SQ or SZ, are being obtained, but will have different volume parameters. And then we give a hint, okay. Which is the procedure to select the significant parameters? You have to measure the good and the bad parts on several positions. Optionally, we have to remove eventually the form, filter out the waveness, and filter out unimportant roughness. Also with a lambda seal you can do this. Measure all the parameters from good and the bad parts, and then select the significant parameters based on mean and level of standard deviations. The question is the parameter significant? If the distance, so if we have a larger differences between the parameters, the bigger then the better for the good part and the bad part, and so this would be the perfect way when you can really distinguish, yes, I have a VMC of 300 for the good part, and for the bad part I have a 100, but not 310. You know, that is not enough. That would be this case. You have to do more search for other parameters, or if they are overlapping too much, then it's not okay. Again, search for other parameters. This is my conclusion. Infinite focus roughness measurements are comparable to tactile roughness measurements in order to consider everything what we said about profile length or the same cutoff wavelength, the same position. Infinite focus roughness measurements are traceable to the national standards, and with an infinite focus also roughness on tilted surfaces with large working distances can be measured. Thank you for your attention. If there are any questions, I'd be glad to try and answer them.
Obávám se, že podrobnější druh informací asi bude sežrat v současné době.
Já si to prostě nechci víc.
Má to někdo dotaz? Nemá tady momentálně dotaz k dispozici, takže to jeho dosáhnout do vaší paměti nevadí. Můžete dotaz položit během návštěvy společnosti Hofmeister, která se odehraje zhruba za půl hodiny, 20 minut. Čili pak vlastně můžete konec konců vlastně tady jeden měřící přístroj, který tady byl prezentován, který měří právě na základě optického měření. 20 minut je dlouhá doba, tam vedle je teda stále občerstvení, myslím, že to občerstvení mezi tím a ve 4 hodiny teda odsud budeme odcházet zástupci firmy Hofmeister, kteří dále pan Kutýra, pan Sivlátka. Takže vás tam dovedou. Jinak je to kousek, možná se to jenom asi 300 metrů. Děkuji.